worshipers, rather, let's give them a round of applause. Welcome to worship. We are excited. I'm so excited. I can't get the words out. Thank you so much for tuning in, and thank you so much for coming today as we lift up the name that's above every name, and that name is the Jesus Christ. Why not call a friend, a relative, an acquaintance, or a neighbor? Let them know that God is still in the blessing business, and we are praying for the Lord to make a great move in this place today. Convince, convert, and convict hearts that Jesus is still on the main line. If you believe that, stand with me and help me sing a verse or two of that. Jesus is on the main line. Tell him what you want. Jesus is on. Put your hands together. Tell him what you want. Jesus is on.
Praise him in his mighty acts. Praise him according to his excellent greatness. Praise him with the sound of the trumpet. Praise him with the psaltery and harps. Praise him with the timbrels and dance. Praise him with the stringed instruments and organs. Praise him upon the loud cymbals. Praise him on the high sound of cymbal. I've been trying to get here all morning. Let me read this. It said, let everything.
Everything.
I'm going to repeat that. Let everything that have breath praise the Lord.
Amen.
Praise ye the Lord.
Amen.
Amen. You may be seated. Shall we bow? Eternal and all wise God, God our Father, it is again we come before thy presence. Our Father, our heads are bowed and our hearts are humble. Our Father, we are here. We recognize that we are not worthy to be in your presence. We realize, our Father, we are sinners, but yet, our Father, we are saved by your grace. We are humble. The angels even recognize the holiness of who you are. And they wrapped themselves in their wings as they bowed and fell in your footstool. Thank you, our Father, for this privilege to come to you and first of all to give your name the honor and to give you praise. There's none like you, our Father. The heavens have declared. Father, we are your children. You made us, and you know all about us. Your Bible has declared that we cast all of thy cares at your footstool. So, Father, whatever the need is, we know that you already know. Whereas we were disturbed last night and couldn't get any rest, where we look back over the course of the week and our hearts were troubled, we ask, Father, that you will please now speak to us. Give us peace. Give a peace of mind. Our Father, we can't make this journey without you. We ask, Father, that you would do as you declared in your word. Hold our hand as we yet run this race. We don't know what lies ahead, but Father, we know yet you are the head of our life. And so, Father, whatever we are confronted with, we know that everything will be all right. So we ask now, Father, to please now bless everyone up under the sound of my voice. Some need you for one thing, but some may need you for another. But our Father, whatever the need is, we know that you're no sharp on your blessings. So speak to our homes and speak to us. Bless our children, our grandchildren. Our children are growing up in a mean and a cruel world. Our men and women are doing everything that's damnable in your sight. But Father, we know that you rule this world and that you're sovereign. So we trust and believe in you. So help us, our Father, as we go through this life, as we run this race. Bless those, our Father, and other doctors that walked out and say they can't do nothing. But Father, we know that you are a doctor that have never lost the case. We know you are a lawyer in a courtroom. So bless, our Father, this church and bless everyone upon the sound of my voice. But not only this church, but our Father, bless churches throughout this land and their country. Bless the man of God that will stand in John's shoes, that he will proclaim the gospel, and that someone will fall out of their wicked ways and say, what must I do to be saved? Now, Father, we ask that the word of God will come, will rest in our hearts, that we'll be stronger for the journey. Now, Father, I ask you to bless every choir there in the mountain platform. The same Zion songs unto you. We need you, our Father. We need you throughout the week. We need you every day of our life. Now, Father, what is done will be ever so careful to stop and give your name the praise. As we look up to the heavens, we say, thank you. Thank you, God. Thank you for saving our souls, for we were on our way to heaven. Thank you. It is in your darling son Jesus' name we do pray. Amen. Amen. And amen.
How many of you believe? How many of you don't believe? Go to this far.
I don't believe in the Lord.
Welcome. Before they went about the drive, the heart of Cashman Gardens and in the heart of God. Thank you for coming and thank you for being with us on this day. We are certainly thankful that our brothers are singing today. Lord, bless us in song. Help them to sing. They're here to encourage us to sing. Not for them to do all the singing, but we're going to help encourage them to sing by singing along with them.
Amen.
Give them a hand of encouragement. Concerning these three Hebrew boys that we never get Discussion is never complete, never finished. It never stops when it turns in terms of the faith that they demonstrated in a God that was invisible to them,
well,
yet visible enough to trust him even in the fire.
All right.
It brings us to the point where we must remember, my brothers and sisters, that God has made choice of his people. God chose you. Many times we did not choose him. But the shout today is that God chose you. He chose us knowing everything about us. Now get that in your mind. He knows your tendencies. He knows our proclivities. He knows our isms, our kooky things. He knows the exotic things we believe, and yet he chose us anyway. That blows my mind, how a God of his stature could know everything about me and still choose me. Yeah, that's a shout right there. Because if you ever get to the point where you understand you are not choosable, you were voted least likely to succeed in your high school. Nobody thought that you'd be where you are today. Nobody bet on you. Nobody put some money on your outcome. And yet, God chose you. I'm going to let that sit in. God chose me. Question mark? God chose me. Exclamation point. God chose me.
Shooting up a couple hundred thousand Americans over that.
But you're going to fly them over here and send our brothers and our sisters back to where they came from. Something's wrong somewhere with that picture. But that's just my pet peeve. And it could very well be that America would have to pay for what it's got to pay for because of its mistreatment of other people. And my instruments are made up. Oh, brothers and sisters, we're living in some critical times when people are bowing for everything and not standing for anything.
Not
so with these boys. Yeah. They knew that God had chose them. They knew that they had been chosen by God. But what they did not know was, whenever you're chosen by God, there might be some heat up the road. Make no bones about it, Deacon Thomas. You will have some hot times if you're God's choice. Expect to go through something. Expect to have some heated moments. Expect to have some trial and some tribulation. But I want you to know, if God has chosen you, you are built for the fire. Right back there. You have been built for the heat. And that the heat is not going to run you away from God. Matter of fact, the harder it gets in your life, the hotter it gets in your life, the closer God gets to you. The closer God gets to you. So you've been chosen. Say, I've been chosen. Say, I'm a part. I've been sovereignly selected. You may not like the way I look. You may not like the way I dress. That's okay. That's cool. And the gang. I've been sovereignly selected. God laid his hands on you. You've been sovereignly selected. Well, you didn't like that one. You've been eternally taken. Maybe you like that one better. Say, I've been eternally taken. He took me. When I was in the world, not thinking about God, he took me. He took me unto himself. He brought me unto himself. I've been taken, good, bad, and ugly, yet I've been taken. Sovereignly selected. I've been eternally taken. But here it is, I've been belovedly accepted. He loved me enough to accept me. He didn't wait until I got to be perfect to accept me. He accepted me while I was yet a sinner. He died for me. God committed his love toward us. And then while we were yet sinners, he accepted us. We have been accepted by the beloved. Oh, Lord Jesus. I'm about to bust wide open. Here's another. You don't like those I just had to say? You've been, here's one I think you might like. I've been providentially picked. I've been providentially picked. He picked me. I think I told you about when I was playing basketball in the country. And I was, believe it or not, I've always been kind of short. And pick up basketball. Three on three. And they picked the tall boy. You got a captain who does the picking. Captains do pick. They would pick. He's probably listening. So Wayne would get picked. Hey Wayne, how you doing, man? I know you're on the line. Joe, hey Joe in Oklahoma City. I know you they will pick you too.
Yeah.
Those are my friends. And he'd have his three, and the next captain would pick.
Yeah.
And they'd pick Simon, Repeat. I'm standing there with the basketball in my home. Nobody picked me yet. Nobody picked me yet. And then one of them will say, that's okay, I'll play the next game. I got the next, I'm tired, I got the next one. Let's stay and take my place.
I hear you.
Y'all don't know how that made me feel. To be overlooked six times.
Yes, sir.
And then for somebody to stand up and speak up for me. And I was not nearly as tall as they were. I could not dunk the ball. I could not play good defense because I was too short. They could shoot all over me. But if they let me get set, I could hit from the three-point range. Yeah, they didn't think I could get that far away. But they didn't know that God, if he's going to give you one thing, he gives you something else. But it always gives you something to win with. So I'm not going to be hating on the tall boys. I'm not going to be hating on the better athletes. God always gives you something to win with. Suggest to me today that you don't have to worry about it. You've been providentially picked. Yeah, amen. If God picks you, quit worrying about anybody else who don't pick you. Let it go. Tell somebody, let it go. You've been providentially picked. God deliberately decided that he was going to cosmically cover your life. Oh, Lord, let me repeat that. Push it around. He deliberately decided he was going to cosmically cover your life. And the reason why people are jealous sometimes of you is that because of the covering God has placed on your life. It ain't your fault why he takes care of you. It ain't that because you live that good that he's done what he's done. It ain't because you got that kind of money you live like you live. You have been providentially picked and cosmically covered. Graduate magna cum laude, a summa cum laude, you graduated, thank you, Lordy. Had to get out of here.
Yeah, that's good.
You've been divinely delivered. Let me hurry here. These boys teach me something. They teach me that all. They teach me because all of us are going to have to go through some hard times.
Yeah.
Now let's just discover real quickly how they got into this. Into this fire. Let's get into chapter 3. Well, chapter 1. Mm-hmm. If you go back to chapter 1, you will discover how they got in there.
Yeah.
Can you hand the Bible real quickly?
Yeah.
Those of you who are online with me, go. I hope you got your Bible, not just this. And if you don't, just get to those. I want you to go to chapter 1 and look at verse number 3. See, chapter 1 talks about all these boys. The three Hebrew boys, Shadrach, Meshach, and who? And Daniel. So it's four in chapter 1. All right. So here in verse number 3, he said that master of the eunuchs was given the task of bringing certain children of Israel. These were the children of Israel, these Jews, and the king's seed, and of the princesses. They brought these selected young men to the king's court. And the king was selective in who he allowed to come into his presence. Because verse number 4 says that the characteristics, the resume for these boys, the children of these boys, they were Jews, they were without blemish. In other words, they were good looking. They were nice looking, fine young men. You want an example? Look this way. Nice looking without no blemishes. Fine. I'm gonna talk back to them when you can. Well, I guarantee I'm the favorite. beyond my fault and gives me favor. You are well favored. You ain't the prettiest, you ain't the finest. Yeah, man. You used to be 36, 24, 36, now you're 36, 36, 36. You don't have the Coke bottle figure, but you're at least a 2 liter, and a 2 liter Coke is the same thing as a 36, 24, 36.
Yeah.
Christian. You better forget that. Can I change this, Rabbit?
Come on.
Thank you, Rabbit. Can I borrow it from you, Rabbit? Thank you. Thank you. I can't say it, so see, y'all got to help me with this now. You got to help me. I don't need no harm. I ain't talking about this. I'm talking about it. How can some sisters who, their eyelashes not theirs, their hair ain't theirs, their hips ain't theirs, all that's not really reality, but you want a real relationship with a man?
Yeah. Tell the truth.
Help me, somebody. Amen. No, what you see, if you don't like what you see, hey, look down the road somewhere. Because I am what I am. And my clothes and my stuff don't make me who I am. Now, ain't against looking good. I want you to look good. I want you to be good. I want you to act good. I ain't against that. Look the best you can, but understand that ain't. And your breath stinks, and your come on, talk back to me. That's the real you. Do you love me today? Come on, talk back, anybody. See. So we got this thing mixed up. So these boys were good looking boys. That's what I'm trying to say. I said I'm gonna hold you long today. That's in chapter 1. They were selected because of the way they look and their character, and the king wanted the best. Mm-hmm. That's chapter 1. They talk about Daniel in the same kind of direction. When we get to chapter 2, it's primarily about dreams. And Daniel's interpretive power, his gift of interpretation, because Nebuchadnezzar had dreams. Did not have an interpreter for all of those dreams, but when we get to chapter 3, and that's what I want to argue today is that chapter 3 is about these three Hebrew boys.
Yeah.
And what are their names again? Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego. That's chapter 3. And it opens with the history of Nebuchadnezzar and the image they had set up, and the statue they had made of the king.
Yes, sir.
I'm reminded when you go to Huntsville, right outside of Huntsville, Texas. I mean, you've been up 45 in that direction.
Yeah.
And out of the clear blue sky, almost out of the forest, this white likeness of Sam Houston stands there. Impending, amazingly high, statuesque.
Yes.
If you look up and you don't recognize it, it almost startles you. Because you think it's somebody, particularly at night, when you go through there and you see this tall statue and looks like seemingly out of the woods. And this is what Nebuchadnezzar, the king, had set up, an image of gold. Now he sets it up of gold because gold means courage. Gold means headship. So he wants it out of pure gold because he is the main man in charge of the Babylonian Empire. Oh yeah, he's it. And look how big it is. Its height was 60, chapter 3, verse 1, 60 cubits, and the breadth of 6 cubits. He set it up in the plains of Dura, in the province of Babylon. Here is a 90 feet tall statue of Nebuchadnezzar and a 9 foot wide statue of Nebuchadnezzar, and he sets it up in the plains. But nothing can block everybody from seeing him. Listen, brothers and sisters, when you want everybody to see you, get ready to be a statue. Get ready. If you want everybody to see you, you're getting ready to be a monument to your own stupidity.
Yeah.
I like that.
Yeah.
Amen. When you want everybody to notice you, you're getting ready to set yourself up as an invisible image. Oh, yeah. Because you won't be invisible very long. Because anybody who competes with God won't compete very long. 9 foot tall, 9 foot wide. That's verse one. Did you learn something then? In the plains, we're living. My brothers and sisters, America is living in the plains of Dura. And if we're not there, we're close to Dura. Y'all missed that. We're living in the plains of Dura. We're living where people want to be seen more than heard. Living close to the plains. Dura is in the province of Babylon. Nebuchadnezzar gathered all in the princes and the leadership together, the governors, the senators, and the house of representatives gathered them all together for the dedication of this statue. He gathered them all together and they come up with this old edict, this idea that they were going to have a band to go with it. Because whenever you want to celebrate something or someone, there ought to be some music. So they decided that upon this statue, we're going to let everybody come and stand before the statue of Nebuchadnezzar. And when the band plays, the fanfare.
Yes,
sir. Well, give me a fanfare, musicians. Y'all stay available for me. Y'all didn't know y'all going to be included in this. All the musicians, y'all, y'all play. Give me a drum roll. Put all y'all together. Stand up, get it out. Now, y'all play it all together. Come on, play it all together. Here it comes. Here comes the statue, y'all. We're going back to Babylon. We're going back to Babylon. Now they will play the music. All right? Brother King, come here. Shadrach, come here. Big Shad, come here, Tom. Abednego. Stand up there. Now I want all of y'all to stand up. Stand up, everybody. Stand up. I don't want y'all to bow, but I want everybody to bow. Play the fanfare. Now y'all bow. Raise time. Bow down. Now that was the scene. But these three did not bow. Come on, give it up for these three. For Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego. He leaves it, but he ain't out. All right, y'all sit down now. Now you got the scene, don't you? Have you got it? You got the fanfare. You got the crowd. You got Shadrach, Meshach, Abednego. And And they hatch up this story and say, well, Mr. King, Mr. M, President Neb, you know those guards that you set up over us? Because there's always somebody going to tell it on you. There's always somebody in your business. They said, you know those guards? You know them, don't you? Shadrach, Meshach, get up and go. Now they didn't bow when the music played. Nebuchadnezzar was upset with them, so mad. His visage changed and said, well, they must have not hear the music. I'm going to give them another chance. Bring them out here, and man, I want y'all to play it one more time. The sackbut, the flute, the timbrel, the organ, all of the instruments of worship and praise, I want you to do it one more time. They bring it back out, and they do the fanfare to foolishness. I said the fanfare to foolishness. Because you ought not dance to the music of every drummer. You ought to pick your spots. Are you hearing that? Yeah, and so he plays it one more time. And the same three, Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego, they don't bow. As a matter of fact, they say, oh, King, we heard Karen play. We heard the music. We heard the flute. We heard the sackbut. We heard all of those instruments. Oh, King, we're not careful how we ought to answer you. We understand you are the King. And we understand that choices have consequences. But, oh, King, we are not bowing down to anybody's image. We are not bowing down to anybody's God. Oh, no. And the King was so upset about it. He said, I tell you what I need you to do. I need you to go fire up the furnaces. See, there are more than one furnace. Mm-hmm. Go, come on. I said there's more than one. Go to verse number 19. Go down to verse number 19. Yeah, 19. There it is at the bottom. Verse 19. Here it is, says that they should heat the furnace 1 7 times.
Yes, sir.
Did you just learn something then?
Yes,
sir. See, most people skip to one.
Right.
And they think it's only one furnace. No, one of those furnaces, he says, heated up hotter than the others.
Yeah.
He would not have said one if there's only one.
Yeah. All right,
then. He just said go light the fire.
Yeah.
But there's more than one furnace. So he says, go light one of those furnaces seven times hotter than the rest of them. Because I want to erase everything about these Hebrew boys. I want to get rid of them, and I want to get rid of their dreams. Because there are some people who want to kill you and your dreams. Oh, y'all preaching? Am I doing all right? Y'all got a little more time? Don't hang up on me now. So he said, write that one seven times, seven meaning complete, seven times meaning sufficient. Because I'm gonna put them in that special fire. And did you not know your enemy's got something special waiting on you too? Yeah, man. Your enemy's got a specific furnace hotter than the rest of them. And they're waiting, and they're gonna light that one and get that one readier, if that's a word, readier than the other furnaces, because that one is specially designed to get you out of the way. Bible says in verse number 20, that is, and I'm finished. He says, since they did not bow, he commanded that the mighty men, he got the biggest and the baddest soldiers out of his army that were in his honor to first bind up Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego. Stand up, Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego.
Yeah.
Now, I need you all to go sit over there with Reverend Brother Reese over there, because y'all bound together. Thank you for this demonstration time. Yeah. And I want, this is a participatory sermon.
All right, man.
They over there, put your hand behind your back. They are bound.
Yeah,
amen. I said they're bound now. Yeah, amen. You've been trying to bind them for a long time, but they're bound now.
Uh-huh.
And so they are bound, and these mighty men, army men, gather them, Shadrach, Meshach, Abednego, and they throw them in the midst of the fiery furnace.
Uh-huh.
Now, why did they put them in the fire?
Uh-huh.
They could have just killed them.
Yeah.
Water fire. And I've been reading this text and preaching this text for many, many years, but I said to myself, self, there's a quicker and a shorter way he could have done this.
Yeah.
If you want to get rid of them, you ain't got to go to all that trouble. Just get one of your soldiers to cut their throat. Stick a spear in there. While fighting. But and then I discovered that Nebuchadnezzar did not choose to fight.
Come on, girl.
Ooh, some of y'all said, could I have invited? I ain't never seen this in it. I'm telling you. You thought Nebuchadnezzar chose to fight. But that would make Nebuchadnezzar all powerful. And God getting ready to show us that no matter what men choose for you, they didn't really choose it. I allowed them to do that because my Bible, I have to put it in there, what you choose for evil, God meant it for my good. And I need everybody, since it was a public demonstration, I need everybody to see how the public results gonna come out. Stop you now. They in the fire now. I'm gonna stand up in just a minute. So he says, I'm going to choose these three men because I know these men. I built this fire for these men because I want to show everybody that I am the God who can handle any fire. So number one, they put them in the fire. They put them in the fire for about four reasons. And I'm going to give you these four, and I promise you, I'm going to sit out. As soon as I give you these four, I'm going to sit out. I mean, you know that's not going to be true. Verse 20 says, they put them in the fire to mar their beauty. M-A-R-R, to mar their beauty. See, they're good looking. And the enemy wants to mess you up so that you will not be recognizable. See, the next storm you go through and you come out of it and people look at you and still recognize you. Your head is still up. Your spirit ain't down. The next time you go through and you still got joy in your heart. Got the courage to go in, anything you want to go in, I go back in tomorrow too. As a matter of fact, I'm so trusting in God, I'll go in a fiery furnace wearing a pork chop suit. Because I know the Lord will see me through. But they're good looking.
Yeah.
And the enemy wants to mock their beauty. That's number one. They want to get rid of those tall, dark, and handsome looks. They want to get rid of those fine looks. So they put him in the fire to mar that beauty. Secondly, they put him in the fire to destroy their fashions. They put him in there to destroy their fashion. Look at it. Look at verse 21. They didn't even take time to put them in some fireproof clothes. They put them in the fire wearing their own clothes. They didn't put them in an orange jumpsuit. They didn't put him in a white striped jumpsuit. No, the Bible says when they put him in there, these men were bound in their coats, their own coats, in their own socks, holes in this, you know what holes, in their own hats. They didn't take time to take the hats off the men. No, and they put them in their other garments, and they just threw them in the midst of the fiery furnace, and they put them in there to destroy their fashions. You see, God has made you fashionable. His children are fashionable. Amen. God clothes you. Amen. God fixes you up and clothes you in the majesty of his own ideas. He clothes you. So Nebuchadnezzar said, don't take him out of what God put him in. Put him in what God put him in. Because I'm going to destroy that. Leave them in what God gave them. And watch me get rid of God. Don't change them. Leave them in their suits. Leave them in their ties. Leave them in their hats. Leave them like they're going to church. Because I'm going to destroy their fashions. Mom, that beauty, destroy their fashion. But the third thing they tried to do with this fire was to melt their strength. Because chapter 1 says they were strong, healthy, vibrant men. Like these three right here. Strong, healthy, vibrant men, but the fire was there to melt their strength. My brothers and my sisters, on my way to my seat, I need to tell you your next fire is designed to melt your strength. The next fire you come to in your life, whether it's today or any day, is designed with one thing in mind. For you to get weaker. And so many people have allowed the corona fire, have allowed this time of pandemic to weaken them, to weaken their faith, to weaken their commitment, to weaken their deciding and their decisions for God. I ain't got the one more. Tell your neighbor, he ain't got the one more. Oh, the fire was designed to mar their beauty. The fire was designed to destroy their fashion. The fire was designed to melt their strength. But the fire was designed to consume their glory. That's what Nebuchadnezzar really wanted, was all of the glory. And this fire, seven times hotter, was designed to consume their glory. You see, when the enemy sees your glory, they're not very interested in your story. But they want to know, how did you make it from camp to camp? How did you survive what you've gone through? And you got to tell them, if it had not been for the Lord on my side. Same cancerous fire that others have gone through. I'm going to the eye doctor tomorrow, but I'll have to wait in line to see her because there are other people ahead of me with worse problems than I have. And I have to remind myself that I am not the only one that's going through the furnace of vision. We have a witness somewhere. You are not the only one that's going through something. There's a line in the room already. Do I have a witness in here? You're not the only one that's having trials and tribulations. I'm glad that CVS, when you go get your medication, lets you stand on some stools. They put some little steps, some shoes, and says, stand right here. And whenever I go, there's always somebody standing in my shoes. Whatever witness is there, there's always somebody standing in your shoes. There's always somebody going through something already before you get to the store. The pharmacist is already making up a prescription. Do I have a witness in here? But I told you what the Nebuchadnezzar's purpose was for the fire. Can I tell you what God's reason for the fire himself, for allowing the fire? If you really want to know, I'll tell you, and I'm going to sit out. I really promise you. I'll tell you what it is if you really want to know what God's purpose for the fire is. I don't know if y'all want to know. If you really want to know what the purpose of the fire was for Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego, here it is. It's not to mar their beauty. It's not to destroy their fashion. It's not to melt their strength. It is not to consume their glory. God made the fire to reveal his love. I knew you missed that, so I'm going to say it one more time. God allowed you to go in your fire to reveal his love. Never got a witness in here. Yeah, never kept these. Got up the next morning and said, well, I couldn't rest too good. I need to get down there and see about God's children. They opened the furniture. And when he looked in, the Bible says, he got mathematical on us. He said, I thought we put in three. Y'all don't know when to shout. I counted them before they went in. It was three that went in, and I count four. And the fourth one is, the Son of God, hey God, and I heard Nebuchadnezzar said, well, oh yeah, I thought we, and they answered Nebuchadnezzar and said, yes sir, we did put in three, and we took out three, but whatever happened to the fourth man, who was in the fire, and I found out the other day, he didn't come out of the fire. He's waiting on me to go in my next fire. So he stays in the fire. He's waiting on you. He's waiting on you. Jesus never comes out of the fire. Jesus told me to tell you. I know you're going back in. And you ain't got to call me in. I'm already back.
Can't blow it. See you.
life's ups and downs. I see you coming. But here's your testimony. If that's your testimony, let me see your hand. God's been good to me. God's been good to you. Yeah.
Thank you.